This brand new travel series is dedicated to anyone who ever got that overwhelming feeling to just get away. You know what I'm talking about. To put all that daily grind behind us, load up the car, and just drive off. Whatever it is that tears you down, the mental and physical toil of work, that never-ending commuter traffic, money, finances, bills, or just assholes with leaf blowers. That overwhelming need to just get away from it all. This episode is dedicated to all of you, all the ones with that deep down desire to just get lost. Of course, when I say get lost, I'm metaphorically speaking, at least for today that is. I've done many trips in Ontario heading to the vast northern regions previously, but this time we're heading east into one of the more popular cottage areas of the province, the beautiful Bancroft, Halliburton, Kawartha regions. So it was only fitting that our route happened to take us through Bob Cajun, popularized in song by the late great Gord Downie and the Tragically Hip. The Hip discography was loaded and played on repeat for the remainder of this trip. We'll miss you, Gordy. With no real plan for this holiday break, today most of the day was spent getting us into the eastern, central part of the vast province, and eventually looking for a spot to set up for the night. We've been deep into eastern Ontario before, 1 year ago in fact, when we set off for that fateful Swishaloop expedition. Inspiration from this trip came from a couple of different directions. Brian, our point man on the Star Expedition earlier this summer, is the founder of the Bancroft Overland Club on Facebook. So obviously, there are many places here to explore. The other source of inspiration came from the Ride the Highlands website. Many years ago, long before the Bronco took over my life, I was into sport bikes, and this region offers incredibly scenic and twisty ribbons of well-maintained tarmac to explore. I caught myself a few times pushing the heavily loaded Bronco just a wee bit harder than I should have in the corners, but just watching the scenery roll by, I think I'll definitely be coming back here for another drive this autumn. A familiar spot to us last year, and for our first overnighter on this trip, was that old abandoned airstrip north of Bon Echo Provincial Park. You'll recall this one from the trip into Quebec. This is a nice, large, easily accessed location in the region for anyone looking for an overnight stop. By the time we arrived, we were both looking to get out and stretch our legs anyway, so this stopover was a no-brainer. That's enough for one day. We were both also getting a little hungry and ready for some supper. The long history of Ontario Highlands goes back into the mid-1800s. People from all over the world were looking for a new start, a new destination to thrive and to settle. This region quickly became one of the more diverse regions in all of Canada. Determined, hard-working, salt-of-the-earth settlers, working away in logging or mining or in the fur trades, took up residence here to call this home. Of course, infrastructure also needed to be built in this wild, vast, forested, and hilly terrain. Situated on top of the Canadian Shield and dotted with hundreds of lakes, guaranteed that most of the roadways yet to be built would be tastefully twisty and scenic. So as a bit of a homage to those immigrant settlers and road builders of the years past, tonight's dinner would be Danish hot dogs. Yeah, you heard right, Danish hot dogs. As far back as the First World War, street hot dogs were popular in Germany and before long became popularized in the Nordic regions of Sweden and Norway. By the 1940s, laws were passed in Denmark requiring hot dog vendors to be self-employed, ending the trend of greedy wholesalers dominating the market. This encouraged owners to put more care into their wagons and the hot dogs themselves, as this wasn't just a job anymore, but a lifestyle. In post-war Copenhagen alone, there were no less than 400 hot dog vans scattered across the city offering their wares. Today, with the influx of other fast foods, they're not so numerous. Despite this, the hot dog vendor is a treasured national emblem and still holds a special place in the hearts of Danes still today. Danish hot dogs. Who knew? What separates these from what we typically think of a hot dog should be is arguably the crisp, quick pickles, and a special Romulade spread. fried crispy onions are a nice dog garnish as well. It would be nice to have some fire grilled wieners for these dogs, but with the resources being what they were at the airstrip, I had to resort to the next best thing. With the Danish remoulade, crispy onions, mustard, and some quick pickles, these were easily the best hot dogs I've ever had. And what else are you going to pair a Danish hot dog with than a nice cold pint of two-bird lager? With dinner finished and cleanup started, I just had to investigate this odd, intermittent sound we kept hearing at the edge of the airstrip. Whatever it was a weird sound, and pretty loud. I was somewhat hesitant to investigate further, imagining whatever it was making this sound had to be fairly large and, well, potentially lethal. Whatever it was, must have been on the inside and not under it. Either way, it was definitely aware of my presence, so I decided the best thing to do was just let it be. What a good end of the day. Beautiful late summer weather, no biting insects, and still quiet and peaceful. Lexi normally doesn't stay up too late, and I'm sure she was pretty tired with all the driving today. Tomorrow was going to be a big day of exploring, so I guess we kind of both needed a bit of rest. I honestly think she likes sleeping in the rooftop tent even more than I do. She's a funny girl. First thing the next morning, Lexi gets her ritual walk. She's pretty routinized, even when we're away from home. So if she doesn't get to check all the boxes every day, she definitely lets me know. Before we went to bed last night, a Titan Swap Nissan Xterra came through and stopped by. I mentioned on the Star Expedition how much I like Matisse's mostly stock Nissan, but this thing was a beast. Go check him out on Instagram. Unfortunately, I was fresh out of TL Overlander stickers, but they had some vinyl badges to share. First for the Bad Mule 2. Thanks, guys. With the dog fed and walked, I just scarfed down a yogurt and a granola bar for breakfast, and I wasn't going to go anywhere without a travel brew. In the preseason, I bought a compact stove burner from Fire Maple to use with blended fuel canisters so I could easily store them in the rear drawer setup. You just never know when you need to pull off the road and fix yourself a hot cup of coffee. Alright, time to hit the road. So the Ride the Highlands pamphlet and GPX nav data are nice references, but they're curated for more mainstream travel with some gravel road exceptions. What we really wanted to do was get off the beaten path, naturally, and of course, Brian came to our rescue again. He uploaded to me a few routes he saved on Gaia in the nearby area, and with them loaded up, we were promptly off the highway and onto the trails. At our earliest convenience, I decided to pull over to air down, more so for ride comfort than anything else. These were some nice trails, not too overgrown, and technically enough that I more often than not needed to find a line over the obstacles. Not overgrown as far as alders are concerned, but of course, the odd branch here and there that needed to be taken care of. This particular route is used as a snowmobile trail in the winter and, not surprisingly, along a hydro right-of-way. One particularly rough section actually had a bypass on it, but even the bypass was unexpectedly rough and slow going. This route was obviously popular with the ATV crowd as well, and with the weather being as nice as it was on this weekend, there were lots out enjoying the trails. Some of the trail overgrowth is old and high enough for the side-by-sides to scoot under, but I didn't want the roof scrapes all day long. Whenever I'm on trails I've never explored before, I keep an eye on the GPS satellite layer, looking for offshoot side trails, particularly the ones leading to lakes. More often than not, they can take you to these epic camp spots. This particular one I started down ended up having a small party of ATVs coming up the other way. And I guess it's a good thing too. I dropped the pin on Gaia anyway and carried on down the trail. The route eventually opened up to a logging road, which eventually opened up to a gravel road. With most of the afternoon spent off-road, I kind of missed the opportunity to find a spot for the night. When you're just winging it on vacation, you gotta expect not everything is gonna go to plan. So here we were, late afternoon, in the middle of nowhere, and nowhere to spend the night. As it turned out, one of our members from the recent Star Expedition owns a cottage right here in the area, and Lexi and I weren't that far from it. With a generous offer to let us set up on the property for the night, we mapped out the location and set off. It wasn't all that easy to find, but with some help, we eventually stumbled upon it. What a sweet little cabin, and what a beautiful spot, jutting out into the lake. This will do nicely. Set up, and with the onboard water being replenished, it was time to get started with supper. Keeping with the multi-ethnic heritage theme, tonight on the menu was a bit of a mashup of Mexican and Chinese foods, mushu pork burritos. Start this simple recipe off with just sautéing the mushrooms and green onions in some sesame oil. As for the mushu spice itself, it couldn't be more simple. Equal portions of ground ginger and garlic salt. That's it, and it's amazing. Once the veggies are done, I put them aside and start with the ground pork. Add the seasoning and continue cooking until browned. Next, we add equal amounts of soy sauce and hoisin sauce. While that simmers, we want to mix up some mayo and some chili sauce to add a bit of zip to the meal. Before we remove the pork from the stove, we want to add some slaw to the pan and mix it up until it's slightly softened, then add back the mushrooms and onions before serving. Spread out some mayo sauce on the pair of your favorite tortilla wraps and sprinkle on some fresh green onions. Add some sliced radish for a crunchy bite and finally dish out the pork. Two of these monsters is a lot of food. One of these would have been satisfying, but I got a bit of help putting them away from Lexi, naturally. And so what do you pair mushu pork burritos with for dinner? I actually haven't the slightest, but I think this local lager will do just fine. While I was planning the chicken dinner one-nighter episode, the meal for that trip entailed a homemade barbecue sauce using some mezcal. Of course, well, I had lots left over from that trip, so tonight I decided to serve up some after-dinner margaritas. As the sun sank lower towards the horizon, the resident loon was having a spirited conversation back and forth with a few people out on their boat. With all the chores done and a warm fire going, it was finally time to relax. Peace and quiet and still. What a wonderful end of the day. Thanks again for sharing your cottage with us. The clouds off in the distance tried to spoil the sunset this day, but I managed to get a few stills before settling in. Following morning, with the sun shining bright, we were packed up and headed out in eager anticipation of exploring what more routes Brian Janis really shared with us. And a couple of these led to some awesome lakeside spots we're setting up, but we'll save that for next time.